Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, students and professors. So I just found a lot of new faces. So I believe that most of you come from outside of our campus. Welcome. So today we are very pleasure and honored to invite Tyson Truman. Okay. So actually we met with each other many years ago, but today I'm a little bit, excited, so I'm sorry. So, as you know, so the Zaha Hadid sperms, it is a very, very famous. And I believe that Zaha Hadid sperm is our young students, internship, the destination, I think, very, very good architecture firm. Not only for Zaha Hadid's words, but also for Patrick's, he will bring us a very bright and smart ideas, not only focused the architecture project design, but also for concerning about the city. So here, let me take this opportunity to give the brief introductions about Zaha Hadid's firm and Patrick Schumann's. So I already speak Chinese here, so I believe that most of the audience is a Chinese one.
各位嘉宾啊，刚才前面开场白说过很高兴，但是略微有点紧张啊，但是不影响大家听啊。这个这一次呢是清华系列的设计讲堂，这一次呢系列设计讲堂呢主要是外国设计事务所系列之一啊。 之前我们也有若干次，那么这一次呢，我们非常高兴和扎哈事务所的 Patrick Schumann 总裁。那当然，他也是他们的首席设计师和总监。那么，清华设计讲堂呢，我们也关注我们清华设计的一个成长。长期以来，我们今年正好是我们清华设计60周年，58年成立到现在。那么，我们也邀请全球著名的建筑师来为我们演讲，分享他们的成果，形成这样的一个学术平台。那么我们今天请到的扎哈事务所的这个 Patrick Schumann赫先生，大家也知道，扎哈事务所他的作品遍布全球，他也致力于创造与周围环境完美融合的具有时代变革意义的融文化、科技、艺术、人文为一体的。 涵盖办公建筑、居住建筑、文化建筑等各种类型的这样一个大型的事务所。当然，我们也更清楚，最近即将竣工的就是北京第二机场，虽然离我们还比较远，但是我们想一定会去那儿参观。那么，他也拥有近40载的设计经验，已经在17个国家建成了53座建筑。 目前正在全球开展项目多达93个。那么今天呢，我们有幸请来的 Patrick Schumann 先生，那么我在这里面呢也简单的做一个介绍。舒马赫先生呢是哲学博士，德国建筑学学位，英国注册建筑师，英国皇家 RIBA 的会员，他是扎哈哈迪德建筑事务所的合伙人兼总裁。 同时是英国建筑学院联盟就 AA 设计研究实验室 DRL 的创始导师。他从2016年3月开始以总裁的身份领导扎哈哈迪德建筑师事务所。他1988年加入扎哈哈迪德建筑事务所，将扎哈哈迪德建筑事务所发展为全球400强的建筑和设计品牌之一。舒马赫先生曾在波恩、斯图加特和伦敦。 学习哲学、数学和建筑，所以大家也会了解为什么他对这个 parametric 这一块有那么样娴熟的技能，这跟数学背景有关。但我知道我们清华学生的数学相对 low 一点啊。他于1990年获得建筑学学位，那么2003年起作为公司合伙人，同时也是公司所有项目的领导者。2010年，舒马赫先生与扎哈迪德一起，以位于罗马的21世纪国立意大利艺术与建筑博物馆 赢得了英国皇家建筑学会 Stirling 建筑奖，啊，同时舒马赫先生也是柏林艺术学院的院士。1996年，他在伦敦创立了英国建筑联盟学院设计研究实验室 GRL， 并一直教任于此。1999年，他在克拉根丰大学文化科学研究所完成了博士学位。舒马赫先生呢，目前正也在世界范围内很多著名的院校担任讲学工作。当前呢，他也是哈佛 GSD 的客座教授。在过去的20年里，他为很多的建筑期刊、文集也撰写了文章和专著，超过了100余篇。2008年，他创造了参数化这个词，参数化主义吧，这应该叫parametricism， 并出版了一系列促进参数化研究的书籍，那么参数化这个词呢，现在大家耳熟能详，已经成为了21世纪新时代的风格典范。在2010年和2012年度，他又出版发行了他的2卷理论文献《建筑学的自创性》，建筑学的自创生。至此呢，舒马赫先生被认为是建筑、城市规划以及设计领域最杰出的思想领袖。我想今天他带来的演讲，以及刚才在演讲前我们短暂交流，也谈到了在未来和我们建筑设计院的实际项目的合作，以及在我们建筑学院执教，以及作为我们职业实践和职业教育层面的合作者，我们非常充满着期待。那么接下来让我们有掌声欢迎舒马赫先生的精彩演讲。
Translated on the slides as trans characters. Just very briefly with respect to Zionist architects, our values are complexity, order, and legibility. Because I believe that the complexity of the city is a necessity because we're living in the contemporary world with much more societal complexity, and this complexity delivers new levels of prosperity, a more complex division of labor, and that offers challenges for orientation and legibility of the city. And that is a challenge we as architects need to confront. And this new language of architecture, which I've been calling parametricism, is all about making new levels of complexity legible. So I'll just fly through a number of images to give you a first impression of what this new work looks like. So there's variety, there's dynamism, complexity, and also internal complexity within the buildings. Not only between buildings, but in each building there's a complex arrangement of spaces. And what is new, we can see here, these buildings are not isolated, they are integrated and embedded into a texture, so there's continuity between all the components of the city, because we're coming together in the city to cooperate, to connect, to communicate. We also started to contribute to China. China is changing its character from a manufacturing-based society across the world to one which is more focusing now more and more on research, development, the service sector, marketing, finance. It's a different kind of process which needs a new city. And for instance, university and space of learning were critical. This is university building we designed in Vienna. And these are the kind of spaces we are interested in, where many things are interconnected visually, communicate within the building and across to the outside. So in this building you can see this idea of complex interconnected spaces which are nevertheless legible and can be navigated and have certain clarity. Our project imaging, you're familiar with this, is our own office is actually located in the room. And the same story of many cooperating companies and places coming together and intercommunicate on many levels in a three-dimensional configuration. This is another research and development institution. Conference center. Our project in Macau, the hotel. And again, the idea here is of internal openness and interconnection of many spaces to create the complexity rather than simplicity of separation. Complexity of integration of interconnection. Cultural center in Changsha. We have an opera house, sorry, museum, and multi-purpose hall. And again, a lot of internal openness, interconnectivity within a building, between buildings, to create a synthesis of many events. That's the whole purpose of coming to the city. To interact and synthesize. Beijing Airport on site. A big communication hub. So that's what the components are of the eloquent city, the city that communicates its complexity. So this slogan is important. Architecture must speak, architecture must communicate. All design communicates. And this was the slogan, in fact, of postmodernism, aphenomenism. And this is the old city, this is the city of the 20th century. I call it the new city, a city that does not speak. Because it's monotonous, it doesn't tell us what's going on. There's a problem, you don't know where you are, where you're going, what is happening. And I know two images. That speechless city, that mute city. Not only in China and Russia, all over the world, the 20th century of modernism. This was not only, this was also conceived already in the 1920s. And this is what we have now. We have not the speaking city, we have the noisy city. complexity, yes, but married with visual chaos. So the question is, what is the eloquence? It is not the mute city, it is not the noisy city, it's the speaking city. So the solution is what I call complex, variegated order. This is actually what you find in nature. So we're going back to history. We need to understand what changed, why the city must change. So this is the 20th century. You can see here, even 1927, Hilversheimer had the vision of the modern industrial city. 50 years later, this became the truth, or it through the next decades. But also, it became a critique, the sameness. There's an ironic statement by Super Studio. In 1969, Hilversheimer's vision has become some kind of dystopian nightmare, and we're moving away from this in postmodernism. So this is an ironic statement. This is a critique in 1969 against this world of the mute city. And we have postmodernism, start to have variety. But very quickly that becomes an unmanageable problem. This is Van Kolas. And in 1980 at the Venice Biennale, we have this idea of architecture must speak. But here the idea is to go back to history and then make many more teams bring together. I think this is not the answer. Okay, so we'll come back later. So I step back and a bit of fundamental theory of architecture. It's a positive problem. We have to think about the development of society from a simple, small society to larger and larger societies. And these larger societies pose the problem of order, and architecture is part of the solution. And with larger cooperation and larger societies, we get more prosperity, a more complex division of labor, and that's what we need to contribute to. So I'm saying that the city is the ordering device of society. Society relies on it. But also, that's where society is evolving, because in a city you can gradually build up and gradually build up the complexity of society. Because there's a physical substrate there which can slowly build up. So it's like the DNA of society. We start with very small structures and they remain stable across generations and can slowly can build up. That's very important, from very small arrangements to larger, and the interactions of human beings are always structured by the spatial relations. I also use some Chinese examples to understand the social order, the hierarchies, the social roles, the protocols of interaction. You need the spatial organization. And that is something we're now starting to work on. So you can see here that the architecture of the four cubes helps to order people into these four pairs. You give structure to the event, and of course it's very simple, but you can on a more complex way. So we're now interested in architecture always in relationship to structure and human interaction. So we can now always study what the meaning of architecture is, which is what happens within it. And we can do that on a new level of complexity. Also dynamically. And without architecture, you cannot have a structured interaction. So a lecture is impossible without a lecture, or without a kind of order of orientation and stuff. And I think this is a universal of human history. So you'll find the more higher and complex civilization have the more larger cities and more complex variety of types of spaces, types of furniture, types of people. And design is very important for that. And it is impossible to have an organized state without an apparatus, an administrative machinery which structures that process. So it's like a social machine. City is a social machine. And you need to pay attention to two things. To the different spaces and arrangements, but also to the different types of people. Male, female, different orders of ranks, different roles, and you can see that people look different. They have different. So design is not only design of spaces, design is also fashion, hairdo. It is necessary to have social order. It's a human universal. And it is also design. I'm thinking of design not only architecture, but I also think of design, product design, furniture design, interior design, and fashion design. You can see who are the different actors and where they are located relative to each other. So this is the idea of semiology, which you can apply to the dress code, but also to the architectural code. And there is no society without this ornamental overlay, but the ornamental overlay is not only human overlay, but also architectural, graphic overlay, a semiology. So you can see that there is graphic on the buildings and on the people, and on the products and everything. And that is a key difference between an animal group and a human group. The settlement spaces, but also the design overlay to differentiate the social order. So we also have to become, as the society becomes more complex, we also get more complex and varied self-expression, as well as expression, different expressions in different spaces and buildings. So this is the 1980s. There's a lot of variety and options, who you want to be, how you want to look like, who you want to group with. That is design. Very cool Beijing youth. And you can also learn there's a whole spectrum of choices, of self-sorting and degree of formality and professionalism or casualness. So you have options also to dress up for each occasion. And we are also involved in fashion design, personally. Okay. So that is not trivial. This is a necessary substratum of cultural evolution, of societal performance. It's a little bit like playing chess. You have different roles, different figures. And then you need, you have to also need the space of interaction and the rules of interaction. And this can take different forms. So we talk about the fashion system as a semiological system. And this ordering, which is also a ordering through communicating through a visual code, it's not only ordering with putting things apart or close to each other, it's through articulating through visual code. That is our core competency as designers. And another metaphor, you can look at chess or you can look at a sports game, and you see that there are different segments, different parts of the space. And each part has different rules. So you know how to interact. So architecture is not shelter for me, but it's about ordering social processes. That's what makes it important. So again, the elements are, you have a space, you have demarcations, different zones with different rules of interaction, and different types of people, team A, team B, the referee. These are the ingredients which we need to think about our task. That's why we're modeling the space and the different people. So we are now have a research program with PhD students and some researchers in the office, where we're starting to look at the different spaces, the different actors, and what these spaces mean in terms of ordering the interaction process. And these kind of processes in the contemporary world, they become more lively, the actors are more varied, the situations keep changing, yeah. And there's more going on. Not only you come in the morning, sit down, and you go home in the evening, and you just do one thing. It's much more dynamic, much more complex, much more varied, and the people are not all the same, each of them is different. Again, this is a central message of this lecture. And this is communication. Architecture must speak. The city must become eloquent. Not only the overall city, but each space. Tell us what's going on, who is coming, what are the options, how to behave, how to interact. So design is a medium of communication. And another analogy, metaphor, is like the coordination of the complex traffic systems. There is a semiology. You understand what the difference between a straight line, a dashed line, traffic signs, lights, zebra crossing. This is the whole sort of coordination of traffic is happening through a visual language. And I'm saying, use that as an idea. Look at the whole city like a visual language. Except what goes on is much more complex than just driving. It's many more complex interactions which are required. So you can think of designing a large space, a university campus, and developing a particular language or code, particular meaning, so everybody is oriented. Because in a contemporary society, you're not just going to the same place every day for 20 years. It is like when you drive through the city, the same traffic language can guide you through every city. And a visual language might guide you through all the parts of the university or all the different universities. So you don't have to know the complexities of your place, You just need to know the languages best. And again, we're trying to show that the meaning of these languages is how people act, gather, move, stop, recognize each other, ignore each other. So there's a protocol, like in the traffic, each signal has a protocol of behavior. In the design, each aspect of your visual surrounding has a protocol of action. So, now I'm going back to history, again, to show that we need to think about this problem of ordering of social processes through a spatio-visual language. We need to think about this historically, because the society today is very, very different, much more complex and dynamic than the society 50 years ago, 300 years ago, 1,000 years ago. But the problem is similar. It's about ordering societal process. So you go from the simple village to the town, becomes more complex, more large. And these kind of towns exist in many variations. There's always the same type. For instance, in European villages, there are hundreds and thousands of these towns all over Europe. One language, one system, one type of society, feudal society. Always the same ingredients. The next stage was the Renaissance, the ideal city. For the first time, this is not just evolving naturally, slowly, without consciousness. There's no conscious design of cities for the first time. Very similar to the medieval town. Very soon, a different kind of city, the Baroque city. This is not only a city-state, this is now a large national country like France, Versailles, much larger, integrated, not bounded to one city, the whole nation. And then the 19th century, you go away from that order into a sprawling industrial city, laissez-faire capitalism. The 20th century, comes kind of ordered state capitalism. Also, this is the industrial city, 1924, Le Corbusier. This scheme of the 20th century is also compatible and was also applied in the socialist countries. This is the era of mass mechanical reproduction. These are the visions of Le Corbusier in 1924. Just to explain this, you have the business district, CBD. You have the residential district. You have the logistics retail district. And you have the manufacturing district. So it's separate zones, each of them very different. But only five, and each one very repetitive. So it's a very simple formula for an industrial city, which was developed in the beginning of the 20th century, and then was rolled out, and it happened around the world. Now we don't like it anymore, but it was a huge success. Mass mechanical reproduction. But this model could not continue, was not this kind of city. We have grown out of the city. We are no longer satisfied with the city. It's too monotonous. There's only five things. Life is very boring. Yes, you have a washing machine, you have a TV, you have hot water, you have a car, but also everybody has the same mass mechanical production. But also life is very simple. Every day you go to work, you go home, go to work. Once a year you go to one package holiday, you come back. everybody's doing the same, all separated. So it is a certain level of prosperity, but also not much variety, not much stimulation. So we can do more. We demand more from our lives now. So this city is no longer adequate. This city is no good. We don't want that anymore. We want much more. We can have more. So this idea of the simple industrial city which you can plan, these five paths you can draw and say this is this CBD, this is the retail, this is, somebody can think about it. That's no longer possible, but it's much more complex and organic and dynamic. I think so you can see in 1980 things changed. Moving from the industrial forest city to the post-forest. Why? Because production system changed. So this era of forestry, you make five things millions of times for decades, and everybody is working. Here, you still make cars, but all these cars could be different. Nobody is here anymore. And the robots can do something different every day. That's why the city is very different. Actually, the people who have been working here, now they come in the city, they can think about, they can research, development, be creative, marketing, finance, to think about how to reprogram the robots next week. So they come to the city to talk, to communicate, to think, to develop. And not to work. So this is the way we have to look at architecture styles and city form historically. And this is very important, a theory-led history of architecture. It's not the history of architecture, just listing the styles, the architects, and saying this we came after this, after this, after this. No, this is uninteresting. We need to understand why these different eras, these different styles are important and had to change because society, the socio-economic and technology of society has changed. I like Karl Marx because he said that technology is the driver of history. Technology changes, social relations change, then I say the city must change. And what is new is the technology of computation and telecommunication, which makes everything flexible and reprogrammable. And that's why it's also important that architecture starts with changing, but architecture is also changing its capacity through computation. And we can design much quicker. So that is why we're moving from this manufacturing city to the research, development, and finance city, right? Something like London. And from this boring monotony, you do something very complex and mixed over there. And I believe that the pieces of this new city should look like this. So, I'm saying the city is like the super brain of society. It's not anymore a workshop. The city is not a workshop. The city is a brain. And research, development, finance, marketing. It's a knowledge economy. It's a creative economy. So Marx is right about this too, that if we have a new technology, we need new relations, social relations. We need to talk, we need to reinvent ourselves, we need to change firms need to break up, to converge. Each project is multiple firms coming together, not one firm, so there's many different... We cannot go 9-to-5 work, we have to have continuous learning, all social relations change because technology changes. And in the social relations, we're going from this diagram This is a corporate diagram to this kind of social relations of production. So this looks like the forest city. This is the new city, and this, we need to, the question is, what does the city look like for this social platform? And we look at work environments, and they look very different now. So we're moving from the left to the right. And we're working a lot with big companies. How does Google work? How does Facebook work? How does technology centers work? They look like this. Much more dynamic, much more complex, more rich, much more open. Maybe like this. And we need to study what's going on inside. It's not just you sit down for 10 hours and you go home. It's much more than that. So we need to study the social process in order to understand what spaces need to look like. Because we can no longer, it's no longer trivial. We can no longer assume everybody comes in the morning, sits at the desk, and then goes home. It's not that simple. Okay, there's one lunchtime where you go to the canteen and then you go back to work. So it's much more complex than this. And the space, and you need to understand everything is moving, you need to know where everybody is to participate in the dance. It's no longer just sit down. That's why the spaces need to look like this. You need to be able to see what's going on. You need to, I think buildings have to become hollow so that you can see what everybody's doing, so you know where you might want to participate. That's why we propose towers, everybody should be internally hollowed out, and to have intervisibility and intercommunication in these kind of spaces. Everything comes together instead of everything is separate. Again, historically, we need to, because we have this, we need this. So this is the steps. And there's a reason why we developed from modernism into postmodernism, deconstructivism. You can see the complexity. And I think we need to go to paramagnetism. So there's a historical necessity for this architecture to adapt and change. Of course, you can still have a contemporary society in a modernist frame, but it's wasting everybody's time, it is difficult, it is inefficient. You have to use GPS to find each other, you cannot navigate. So it is possible, but it is not useful. So it is much more important to develop the new city, the paramagnetism city. And that's some quick rehearsal of the ideas of paramagnetism. Because everything is now dynamic and interrelated, connected and communicated. And really there's a big shift, because before architectural composition was just taking the five things, simple shapes, and just placing them next to each other on a grid. And now we have to create something which is very fluid and flexible. It's a very different way of working. And we also have to use new tools, algorithms, to allow this to happen. So it is really a very deep change with the fundamental components and methodologies of architecture. So instead of drawing lines with a ruler, we need to have an algorithm finding complex organizations. It's very difficult to do this by hand. These are not simple grids anymore, they are very specific. And so this is some of the architecture coming out of that, connecting different directions of the urbanism, open, continuously changing spaces, not A, B, C, but continuously evolving. Also, instead of making simple flat surfaces, you create something which is varying, which is pulsating, which is interacting. So it's very much more dynamic. And this is going on for quite a while now. It's not three things, it's continuously varied conditions. Organizations like this, it's not just A, B, C, but much more complex elements come together through this, with degrees of separation like this. And the idea of adapting to existing conditions and to vary and change, but not random, but gradual transformation. So there's an ordered, varied complexity. So these are different stages of parametricism. And we'll talk later on, there's a later stage called tectonism. And I will not talk too much about this, this is a separate lecture. But tectonism is the latest stage. So instead of having only these fluid surfaces, but simple surfaces, you get much more variety of geometry and texture, reticulation, materiality. So this the new stage of parametricism, which is, has a much more expressive and varied language to organize even higher levels of complexity and variety in society. So parametricism is now 25 years old, it goes also in stages. Foldism, globism, swarmism, now tectonism. So it is an evolving paradigm. It's not one thing, it's continuously evolving. And you can see the, I'm just looking at the workshop going on here in Chihuahua, based on fabrication logics, that is tectonism. You can see that the structures and organizations you see in the workshop, they're all very fluid, organic, but each of them is very different. It's not only one thing. That's tectonism. It's the latest stage of parametricism. But it also applies to, I'm going now to talk about urbanism again, and the contemporary urbanism, what I call parametric urbanism, and you can see the variety. And you can see already that this is varied, complex, but it is also too monotonous still. So this is our own parametricism project. They're much better than the modernist project or the deconstructivist, but I'm now criticizing this. This is too monotonous, too simplistic. We need more variety in this. In reality, we've gone from here to here. We've gone to raw collage. There's no order, just pure variety. But what we need is order variety. Nobody has planned that. So I'm also saying the ability to plan the city is disappearing. It is more a bottom-up process. So that's the premise from socioeconomy. But, and that is happening all over. It is vital, it is important, it is necessary, but it is also, there are some problems in this. So I'm critical of this. And these cities are not planned. They cannot be planned anymore. And that's a very important message. These cities are post-modernist, the new technology-based dynamic cities, but also they coincide with market liberalization, with the introduction of a market process, also in the urban process. And you'll find that all over the world, to some extent also in China. But we need to understand that this is necessary, which cannot be regretful. We have to understand we can no longer rely on planners to design the city. So we cannot have a top-down approach to the city. Either. And we need to allow market processes and entrepreneurs to come in and develop the city in a collective process, in a bottom-up process. So I call this bottom-up order. And the old order was top-down. The old order top-down was easy, was okay, because there was only five things. Now you have thousands of things, it's very difficult to do a top-down. So we need a decentralized process. And the problem is, we have that decentralized process to some extent, and it can bring the free play of entrepreneurs finding each other, can develop a synergy order, but visually it is total chaos. That's the problem. So architecture has to come in and give a visual order to the underlying socio-economic order. So I think the market delivers the socio-economic order, and the architectural discourse and the profession as a whole has to try to forge a legible visual order. And I think that's possible with hierarchicism. So this is the best we have now, but it is problematic because it is not the eloquent city, it is the noisy city. These cities are dynamic, vital, but it's, they disorder very visually. And nobody, we don't see beauty in them. We all feel there's no identity. They all look the same around the world. Okay, sometimes you recognize one building, but the rest becomes very, very difficult. This could be anywhere. Lack of identity, lack of order, lack of legibility, lack of orientation. You need your GPS to find anything in this. So there's a big problem. So I'm calling this the garbage city. This is Tokyo. And I think it looks like this. This is the same. It's a problem. It's the best we can. So, but interesting that architects have the intuition, and this is vital and dynamic, so it is better than the simple grid. So, the architects, deconstructivist architects, aestheticize, make aesthetic value out of this visual chaos. This is, again, interesting, civic path. So, this. A kind of artistic garbage city. This is a deconstructivist city. And the question is, can there be something else? Can there be the reinscription of order into this? So we have a problem. We have on the one side, we have the monotony of the mute city, and on the other hand, we have the visual chaos of the noisy city, of the garbage city. We have to reject both. Maybe we have to move to the next stage. Complex variegated order. And so there's a question. Is it possible to have both order and this bottom-up dynamism? What do you think? Is it possible? Yes. How? Anyway, so this is is a given, we cannot change this. I wrote an article about this if you want to check this. How is it possible? And I believe it's possible through parametricity. But only if parametricity becomes a universal language of architecture, like modernism was the universal language of architecture in the 20th century. If the 21st century will be universally based on parametricity, we can actually solve the problem. And now I'll tell you how. So this is London. If you look at this, this is garbage city. Also, there's a nice part at the Buckingham Palace, but most of the city is just, and the only thing you can see, anything, the only thing you recognize is the river. Everything else is just noise, illegible noise. So I'm saying here, the only thing is the river, which gives form and shape and orientation. If there was no river, you could see, you'd understand nothing anymore. So we need to look at the river, we need to, and this is the same all cities. So we need to look at nature and natural formation, the complexity, maybe of rivers, or formations which have variety, intricacy, changefulness, complexity, but they have an order. This is not random. Here, everything is random except the river. Here, nothing is random. It's very complex. So we need to look at natural system, and that's when we start to look at development architecture. Like the river, like the natural systems, complex variegated order, you can solve the problem. And now we're looking at these kind of natural formations as inspirations for architecture and design. Look how beautiful, how ordered, how intricate, how complex it is. It's not a good, but it's also not random. It's something what I call complex variegated order. So this is, we can do with computational systems, we can actually reach that and develop that. And again, we look at nature and develop models for architecture. And that is, at this stage, mostly academic research at the AA, the design research lab. This is not lived reality yet. We have some master plans, I show you, the design of the architects, to start. But it's also a process which needs multiple authors. It cannot be one architect, this is impossible. It needs to be the whole discipline coming together and reading, because what is interesting is these, the natural systems, there's no designer. It's system logics. We come to this. So this is our task, and the solution is parametricism, but not single author, but multiple authors, a whole generation of architects working separately together in interlocking ideas. So this is one of our projects, and you can see that the embedding into context. That is only one small fragment. But there's variety, there's order, there's complexity. This is interesting. These are different student projects, office projects, student projects. And this project was multiple students working together. So this is already not one hand, but many hands. And that's what it has to become. The city cannot be developed by one hand. There needs to be many, many hands, but they need to be coordinated, they need to be relating to each other, they need to have an ethos of communication, of integration, of affiliation. So we try some of those. Looking at nature, looking at our sketches. There's a lot of variety. Particularly this, I love this, I call it the multi-species ecology. So this is many different plants. So it is the topography, the water, the sun, the plants, the animals, they all form an intricate order. No God, no designer, many systems independently coming together and generating something which is very intricate and complex and evolving and changing and dynamic. But it's not garbage. It's intricately ordered. There's principles, there are kind of algorithms at play. All of this is rule-based. Each species comes in with a certain rule. Its life process, its life. So this is the analogy, the image I want. What we have to emulate, what we have to achieve. So this is all delivered by algorithms and scripted, but it doesn't need to be one author. New authors come in with new scripts and add to this. Okay? It could be a cumulative process, it could be a sequential process, doesn't need to be a planned process. There's no top-down planning, it's all individual plans. So this is very important, that's the analogy, or we call it multi-species ecology. It's nature-like, it's rule-based, it's differentiated environment that promises to allow for a kind of an animal-like navigation of the endless forms of a multi-author urban ecology. So these environments are complex, but they can be navigated. You know that because human people living in a natural environment, they find a way, they know where is the water, they can see where the water must be, they can see where various animals are. Everything is lawful and ordered. And also much simpler organisms like birds or animals can find their way very easily. Why? But they could not find a way in a garbage heap. Because in a garbage heap there is no logic, there is no order. So we, if we go to the garbage city, we cannot find anything because there is no order. But we could find everything easily if it was order. So there's the analogy of the human orientation in complex systems, city systems, with the animal cognition. It must be possible. So. If all the elements are rule-based, based on algorithmic logic, we can retrieve them intuitively because we have a supercomputer up here. We can learn language, we can learn systems, we can learn logics. So we, better than any bird or animal, we are super attuned. But if there's nothing to learn in the garbage still, you can never acquire the capacity. But if there's something very deeply instilled in order, you'll find your way in this kind of environment. Like this. So, and in a sense, molecular architecture has also been scripted in. Because if you look at molecular architecture, it's very similar to animal species, to plant species, normally designed and they have their own rules. So they're actually quite harmonious, they never look like garbage. So if you look at human settlement, they're never random, they're always intricate because there's certain rules and constraints. So you can look at all human settlements historically, prehistorically, like animal or plant species. Embedding themselves naturally into the built environment. You can find the places. So I like these models. They're models of rule-based systems coming into existing systems, layer by layer, bottom up. Nobody designed the city. Nobody designed any of this. This is just individual, piece by piece agglomeration, like bird building nests. And I think that's what we can rely on. And we find it beautiful, we find it characterful, we find it unique and special and adapted and local and contextual. So we can do that as well now. And again, we didn't design this. It was an algorithm to deliver that. Okay? But we have to, of course, develop the algorithm. And then the next architect comes in, the next comes in. This is also, nobody designed this for us. Very, very well adapted to the topography. So this is the history. That's where we are now. It's a problem. That's the next stage. But it's too monotonous, it's not correct yet. There's only an interim stage. We have some things to show, but it's not the total story. What we need for the total story, we need first of all the freedom to have a bottom-up process. We need degrees of freedom for planners and architects, not individual developers and architects, rather. No prescriptions saying this is what has to be. So we need that freedom, and we need a discourse, a unified discourse, a unified global style of pragmatism and technology to deliver that next stage. So these are just fragments. We are starting to do this, embedding ourselves with our plans. But I want more variety. This is just one architect. All architects need to layer themselves into this. This is some of our master plans. Is it KL or Wuhan? But it's only the beginning, it's only sketches. And again, we need the full variety of tectonism to prevent collapse into monotony even on that level of complexity. So that's the eloquent city we should develop together. It doesn't exist yet. Thank you. So I'm inviting questions. Yeah. I can accept questions in Chinese as well. I cannot answer in Chinese. But
yes, so I thought the next stage is question and answer. So before that stage, I would like to say I'm very sorry. So I lost one thing. So I want to introduce our guests. <笑>那我先介绍一下今天的嘉宾啊，我们也很荣幸他们能一起来参与我们今天的这个讲座，然后参与我们后面的互动。 他们是天安时间当代艺术中心负责人翁玲，谢谢。然后MAD的建筑师事务所建筑师党群，谢谢。然后蒲公坚工作室创始人、主持设计师潘岩，欢迎。然后蒲公坚工作室合伙人唐一萌，欢迎。
然后，张航利的事务所设计师助理梁雅助理是。Thank
you very much. 那么接下来我想这时间就留给各位。那么大家可以提问，最好你提问前先自报一下你的家门啊。谢谢。
The garbage city, what I'm thinking is its independency, that you cannot break the boundary of each place. However, that the computer can do that. They have a center here, center here. So what I'm thinking is, if we want to achieve the most plan that you want to can the AI or the computation can take place of the designer's brain? That they can generate the shape by itself. Do you think that from the place of our job? Yeah, that's my question.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for the question. You asked me about the possibility of an AI takeover of the design process, and yes, in principle, yes. We're very far away from that at the moment. We can use, at the moment, only partial, particular processes using computational intelligence, using also evolutionary algorithms, genetic algorithms, AI subsystems, not the overall yet. And also I would believe that, but you're right, that this relies on the development of AI, the more the better, but I would still believe that each intervention comes in with a developer, with an architect, and with various systems, and it's never a single development of a city. It is always going to be multiple interventions, multiple steps and stages, each of them with a human element and an AI element, I would believe that. But in principle, there's no limitation, and I'm happy because the more we can outsource or develop our skills and enhance our capacity for AI, the more we can step back and have a more general reflection about the purposes and compare different systems, etc. So I'm very positive about AI.
Well, anything else? Somebody, please.
City, the concept of smart city, I welcome it to some extent. At the moment, it is primarily defined through particular technological features which are on offer, like smart energy usage, maybe a high degree of computational integration of building systems, etc. Transport systems maybe will come in. A lot of this is engineering, in the engineering domain, and not necessarily the architectural domain. But I like the concept of the smart city. I think the truly smart city is also something about smart social processes. That means it is about the organization of building the urban spaces. But at the moment, the smart city concept, the way it is developed by technology firms like Siemens and Cisco, etc., is not really living up to and connected up with my thinking here. So it's presupposed. We always presuppose the most sophisticated engineering solution, but at the moment the smart city discourse does not contribute. So we need to redefine smart city as sociologically and architecturally smart, not just technologically smart.
Thank you. Excellent speech, thank you. I have one question. You have drawn a lot of comparisons between parametricism and modernism, and you've spoken about the Radiant City, the Corbusier in the 1920s. How that went from avant-garde at that time to commonplace in a short time of 50 years.
Yes.
And you're speaking about parametricism as the new avant-garde, and it's all that is driven modernism and what's happening now, all that is driven by advancements in technology.
Yeah.
So how do you see the technology advancing in the next century, maybe in the next 50, 70 years, and do you see parametricism becoming commonplace by then, and do you think there will be a new trend at that time, also during that technology, that would somehow come in place, maybe replace that. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you. That's a very good question. And Pan-Africanism is a epochal paradigm in style. So, as I discussed, it has its potential for a series of subsidiary styles. So it is evolving, like modernism. Modernism is not monolithic. It started with the white modernism in the 20s and became the brutalism of the 1940s and 50s, and became the high-tech modernism of the 60s, 70s, metabolism, etc. But it was still always based on the principles of separation, specialization, and repetition. So it was modernism was tied to the industrial city. So, but I welcome the whole idea of avant-garde is to become mainstream. That's validation. So I'm very much in favor of and hope for that parametricism, as it evolves through stages, also becomes really mainstream and takes over. Because if you see that modernism took over in this way, in 1965, every architect on the world, really, self-respected, was within the tradition of modernism, with respect the Corbusier, Mies van der Rohe, Walter Gropius, which is still alive as their masters and as a paradigm and developed the project. So I think that was very important, that we have a global convergence of a whole world architecture to purely come together to deliver this project. And I think that is lacking now. We have now too much fragmentation, too much different styles and confusion. That's why the city is confused. So I very much hope for and proselytize. The whole purpose of my speaking and lecture and writing is to inspire and invite as many architects as possible. It doesn't need to be 100%, but it needs to be some kind of majority to develop that into real mainstream delivery, because otherwise you're not delivering. Modernism delivered, but of course modernism should not continue. We need to deliver something for the 21st century, and we can only do that if we converge. If we all walk in different directions, we, as a discipline, we're failing, because we will have no impact. None of these directions will succeed. So that's very important. Now, the next stage, I don't know. I mean, I think that parametricism, as long as we're in that era of what I call the post-forest network society, of converging into urban, creative industry hubs, communicating with each other face-to-face and coming together in urban centers, parametricism will be the solution. And I don't cannot speculate what the next stage is. I think evolution is unpredictable when it comes to system switches. But within a system, you can predict the kind of cumulative. I know what it would become like if parametricism would take over, would roll out, and would transform. I don't know what lies beyond. Absolutely no idea. That is, I'm agnostic there. And I know at some stage, something else will take place. But it is not from within architecture. It is from a real shift in civilization. So all about the so new technologies we don't know yet. So then I don't know what happens. But as long as this transformation does not happen, I'm convinced of parametricism that we develop the solutions in the avant-garde. The avant-garde is already 25 years working and we're getting more sophisticated, that it is, we are ready now to roll out and make a real impact in the next 25 years.
Okay. First, thanks for your lecture. I'm the PhD candidate from Tsinghua. So I have a question that I'm wondering who gave the definition of garbage? Could you say this? Garbage city, garbage building, right? That's the one question. Second is that with the development of the AI and the computer science, right? So, if in the future the computer is very strong, so I'm wondering if today the computer will think that all the human beings are garbage. So, if that's how we can, as a designer, how we can, yeah, so I'm
okay, wondering. Well, look, if the computer starts to think this, we're gonna switch them off. we reprogram them. So the computers are still our tools, right? And we've made the masters. And so I don't worry about that. But who is defining this? I mean, that is my proposition. I wonder if you agree with this. You'll find the contemporary. And my proposition is this: in the last 30, 40 years, on an urban scale, no order, no beauty, no identity, no characterful, recognizable urban identity has been created. And you get the same chaotic sameness everywhere. Do you agree with that? Or give me an example.
Because identity, I think it's good, but too much. I mean, the scale. Because in China, I think we have philosophy about the scale. You see? Because I think if the scale is without control, if it's good things, it can be bad things. So I'm wondering if long before, if without any identity, it's bad things. But if in the future, too much identity. So it's good for the.
Okay, look, my argument is the following. The prosperity we have, the power human beings on this planet. I mean, for instance, if I want to meet a friend in Australia, I can go to the airport, I sit on the flight, I watch movies, eat some nice meals, and I arrive in Australia a few hours later, right? That power. And I have never to do physical work in my life. And maybe hardly anyone has. Everything is at our fingertips. We can communicate around the world visually or physically and so on. This power, what is it based on? It's based on human cooperation on a world scale. We need to have, it's the complexity of the division of labor which delivers that performance which we all cherish as freedom and prosperity. And that needs scale. It is delivered through very, very large urban centers and metropolitan regions which are working together intricately. Of course, they also network globally, but they're also these. It is really that which drives the scale. So if you, and if you look at the animal kingdom, this differentiation and division of labor, that complex order. If you have a worm, small animal, it's just one muscle, has a few pieces, you can just do this a little bit. There's no chance that if you have a more highly organized animal, maybe a tiger or a human being, all the different parts, not only one muscle, you have hands, legs, eyes, ears, organs, brains, I mean, very, very much differentiated. It's a specialized but integrated division of labor. That gives us a performance. So, the same as if you have a little village. This is very weak. It's like only one muscle, one worm. All an integrated urban power connected, integrated organism. That is scale, but not only scale. It's not the scale of the endless repetition. That's like a huge worm or something. But it's an intricate differentiation of multiple parts, which are all different. That's where the power comes from. So I think we need to recognize this. It's not something, I like this, I like that. We need to recognize what delivers the prosperity and freedom. Where you and you may be 28 years old and you have never had to work physically. But you're roaming around the planet and everything is easy and where's it coming from? Let's need to reflect what the conditions of this are, sociologically, economically, but also architecturally.
Thank you.
好，这样，我还是刚才，他自己说的，希望用中文也可以提问，是这样，中文提问我们有翻译，因为最好的是要教人，好吗？
Thank you, Patrick. And I'm a student from the School of Architecture in Tsinghua. And let me use Chinese first for our translator to translate and maybe to add something later. Yeah. or may use in English maybe. I think we can have a try. Maybe I can have a try. I noticed that you have mentioned many times about the market order and the society order and the building design. And I would like you to explain what's the relationship between these three things specifically. Because I can raise Beijing as an example. In my comprehension, our government, they have an urban plan first, and what they want to do is to restrict the real estate company and the developer of the land. Because you can imagine that, because Beijing is the capital of our country, if we don't restrict the density, the residential rate of the land, and the developer the buy land, and then they will want to make more money, or at most money as possible by maybe adding the layers, adding the density, and that is what market order make them to do. And what our government would do is to restrict it by an urban plan. So I wonder if we don't have an urban plan, we just design as or following the market order, what do you think will happen or will be better maybe in your imagination? Because that is something relating to resource, I mean, distribution, be about architectural design. But can you can resolve it without urban plan or its restriction from the government? Or, yeah, that's
okay.
All. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the question, it's very important. I don't believe, that's not really Beijing government, it's municipal government. It is all the governments, municipal governments in all the world. In London, I know, I'm very familiar with, that the government knows what is the viable and right density, what is the right mix of uses. For instance, I was very fascinated when we had Seoul China, our client, in their first project, they're creating buildings where you could have a retail unit anywhere in the building, on any floor, next to directly an office, next directly to a residential unit. So you would have degrees of freedom not only with respect to density, but also with degrees to program mix and allocations. And the government usually regulates this, but they have no information. Then relative information about what would be the best way. So the market is first of all a discovery process of what is desired and viable, and only if it is desired and viable you can actually make the money. So if you do something which is very dense and you think people find it too dense and don't want to go there, then they cannot sell in the market, so they have to change. But I believe that, for instance, maybe Beijing should and could have far higher levels of density. And maybe the market will discover that. And the government can only choose one figure, and then everybody has to stick with this across the whole city, maybe. I don't know. I would like to see cities and societies risk more degrees of freedom. Because I believe that freedom deliver all, can deliver all. So it's just a hypothesis, I cannot prove this to you. This is just a conviction and debate, an argument. But I believe that the complexity of the potentials is such that the information and knowledge processing capacity of the group of planners is insufficient. You need the full intelligence and exploration, trial and error process of many market participants to find these densities and mixed uses and what connects up to where. Otherwise, you have just a plan. It's very random, really. It's very safe and arbitrary. Or it's maybe not arbitrary, it's very safe and conservative. Yes, you know that you don't make a mistake, but you cannot make radical improvements, but I want to see radical improvements. And I'm willing to take the risk of temporary, local failures
So, yeah, please, sit down, please. So, I believe we'd better allow a much more audience just ask a question, okay? So, I believe the time is pressed. So, further, please. Thank you.
For Parag, it is easy, and also for the Renaissance CD, and also for the modern CD, it was easy because Parag, we know Osman just cut off Paris and made this new scheme. The modernists just extended the city. Now we already have big cities, and also like in China, where the revolution of the city is going to grow, but still the government of Beijing is trying to restrict now the extension of the city. Can paramilitaries squeeze in the city and in the existing city and try to solve it out in some way, or should we like demolish whatever we have? And because if it works as a whole,
No, I don't believe in starting from scratch. I think it's an evolutionary process, piece by piece. But if you look at the dynamism of development of the city, of Chinese cities in the last 20 years, you can really remake the city. Even developed city like London, of course, I wouldn't touch the historic centers. But East London is developing, there's densification, there's about, currently there's about 500 to 1,000 projects going on. Unfortunately right now, they're all prescribed, conservative, stereotypical solutions with a repertoire, neo-rationalist repertoire, which is the same of 18 years ago, so you will not see the impact. But if these were all contemporary parameters and contributions, and some of them also larger sites, I think you would, within 20 years, a real transformation. Even though the high-end city of London is possible, and then they're further developing zones where there is more scope for more radical renewal. So, but I believe it as a palimpsest, I believe it as a transformation. I don't believe it as a tabula rasa mostly, but some are also built from scratch. I think that's not totally, but new extensions, or you have, in the, most cities have central harbor locations, quite large areas, or industrial parts, which are migrating out of the city. For instance, in Hong Kong, now the whole of Hong Kong harbor is set to move out. It's very central. That would be a massive opportunity to really remake a city like Hong Kong. So I see this, but I don't see it as a tabula rasa or as a new city foundation.
What my question is also, like, what is going to happen when the new permanent city and the old city are going to...
Look, that's what we're doing. If you look at some of our projects, whether that's the Maxi project in Rome, or And a lot of projects, even the Amper project, where we put a new building on top of another building. I mean, they're quite, we're trying to weave new into old. And then you have a slow transformation and takeover. And you also see our city plans, you connect up. It's not a collage, it's a trying to weave and connect up, be contextual. But then the old elements become part of something new. They change character, it's kind of recontextualization. So that means in this process, and Hermeticism can deliver this because we can scan and pick up all the existing pieces and start to relate to this. For me, it's always about relationship building and re-transformation, and this will also happen. Even those buildings now which come in Hermeticism, they are never complete, they're never finite. We are quite happy in building in this language to add elements, to evolve, to subtract. So that is a very dynamic process, I believe. Yeah.
Okay, it's an honor for you here. And I'm from the Boston Institute, and I'm a Marxist, so I like you very much. Thank you. And I will read my question in Chinese. Patrick 刚才讲到说, Marx was right, 但是他又后来提到了那个，就是这个。 在现在城市发展中，这个规划变得有一些尴尬，应该让市场做决定。但是如果说按照马克思主义的这些想法的话，其实计划经济是在市场经济之后的一个阶段，就是通过了市场经济以后，当这个生产力更发展之后，反而应该在规划和计划策划这方面，应当有更强的力量。我想请开始就是这个怎么讲？是说我们需要经过一个先到市场，再回到计划的过程，还是说？
还有其他的一些解释，谢谢。Thank you. So I'm a Marxist too, but I'm not sure. So I'm also a critic of Marxism. So what I believe was very important in Marx was the understanding that societal progress needs an economic base and a technological base. Okay? And where he was not right is that the way this base and the social relationships and technologies are best developed is by a planned economy. So I'm a Marxist in the sense of historical materialism, the fundamental premises of all social societal development, but I'm against Marx on the specific idea that this would happen through a planned, rationally planned and anticipated development. I believe that this is a market process has more information processing capacity. So that's why I don't believe in central planning, neither of the urban space nor of the whole economy. And you can see that in China, you move from a very centralized planned economy to a much more scope for market processes on the economy side, also to some extent on the urban side. But I'm saying we can go further steps in exploring the potential of market processes. But you see, with the market process, there's also planning, but it's private planning, multiple planning agents, and I also can imagine coordination there. You have between private developers and entities, they can have industry harmonization, they can have their own conferences, but it should be a voluntary industry standards rather than government. That's my belief. So I'm a Marxist, but I'm a different Marxist in here.
So you agree that you need a process.
Yes.
No, because of the time, so we'd like to, if you understand it, we'd like to give the chance to more officers.
Okay, fine.
Anything else? So English or Chinese? Okay.
Nevertheless, I'm Su from Korea. I agree with your design, Chris, or most of but sometimes your complex design looks like a force of existing things to vanish. Like, for example, you design Dongdaemun Design Park in Korea. Actually, Dongdaemun area is a very, very famous area in Korea, which has a very long historical fashion market. But after you design the Dongdaemun Design Park, actually, personally, I think your design is weird because your design made the area more stronger. But on the other hand, many people also think the Dongdaemun Design Park didn't consider the historical context and layers of the city. So I wonder your opinion on this issue. And also, when you design the urban design which you show in your presentation, how do you deal with the historical things of the city?
Okay, well, I think it's important to realize, first of all, the ethos of pragmatism is always to connect up with what exists, generate synergies, so be contextually embedded, and that also implies social institution processes, things like markets, the fashion market. We knew about it, we considered, and we were hoping that it could be re-hosted in the Dongdaemun Park and Garden. There's lots of spaces, retail spaces, where this could take place. So this is maybe a policy issue, because there's a lot of markets and surroundings. So I would have welcomed this, and we were aware of this and interested in this. We're also interested in keeping some level of historical memory, but that can only be secondary. The city is, first of all, a living engine of prosperity and life, and not a museum. But I'm accepting that, of course, there are historical monuments which deserve to be preserved, and they deserve to be made museums or get a new life. So I'm in favor of historic preservation to some extent, but only to some extent. You need to make, that is a value judgment, what these historical assets really imply. So in Dongdaemun, we have actually some kind of historic relics that take a lot of space. I'm not sure we integrated in the complex, but I'm not sure how meaningful that really is. So maybe there's too much. You can look at some rocks. I don't know how much information that gives you. So we I believe here it's interesting. Even there, I would be willing to risk that could be a question of market choice, whether somebody is acquiring a site and an asset would think that the historical elements could be integrated productively and become a value. And even that, I think we can try to leave the market process, by the way. But I do believe that there is value in historical preservation. But we don't know what the value is, and the market can then discover it.
What's the difficult issue when you communicate with the government to
from the bottom-up order, this kind of particular texture with a strong top-down order. So,
well, look, this is interesting. I mean, the direct communication with the government on these issues is been conducted through the client initially to get the site, to understand what the values are. I mean, the quantum, the densities are, and then later also the design institute. But for instance, with the Galaxy project, there was a lot of interesting constraints. I think it was nice to get a lot of density. There's a lot of light views and angles which you consider, so you're working with the constraints and embedding something. I think though that more degrees of freedom would have been interesting, particularly with a client of like Seoul, China, who have a good history and track record of experimenting with new products in the market. And I thought that in an earlier stage, when you have much more radical mixes of uses, could have been interesting in these projects. But as the Beijing planning matured, it also became maybe more regulatory and radical. So the same I would say with the density potentials. I think one could risk a little bit more. You know, yes, maybe there's an overshooting at some point because somebody makes more, and then you have to withdraw if it was a mistake. But you have to be able, as in life as well as in research development, you have to allow for the possibility of mistake to learn. And so we shouldn't be playing it too safe. That's my message.
Well, thank you, Patrick. Is there anything else? Is there any question else?
当然有中文、英文都有，简短结束一下时间的对话。舒华先生你好，我不太会英文，然后由于部分其实没有太听懂的，但所以我做了一些录音。 也希望能够用更好的英文的同学能够多。那范范范范老师，请多帮忙。其实我想的是一个这样的问题，就是舒华先生您的整个这个就是讲座当中提到的，很多这个就是自主的一些美空间啊很美，甚至自然界的东西都很美，比如说昆虫啊蜂窝森林啊里的那个亚区隔离啊。
那么我们的参数化的这个模式，先让我们开始。先让他翻译一下。这是一个small essay吗？
那接下来的问题是，因为动物节和植物节啊，它们是相对容易的，植物它有它的一个规则，甚至自由法则啊，它有它的规则。但是人是有私欲的啊，每一个人都是不同的。如果我们的这个参数化的这种设计呢，用在一个企业当中，思想是能够统一的，更容易统一。比如说企业的决策者，他有他相对高屋建瓴的东西，能够做得比较好。 那可是，在一个城市当中去运用我们的这种规划的话，在城市当中运用我们的这个规划的话，可能就会遇见非常多的思想的不同，然后企业与企业之间的审美的这个差距，那这个有可能会造成这个我们的这个应用的这个难以实施。不知道舒马先生有没有什么好的一些解决办法建议，能够给到我们晚辈这样子。
怎样把不同的人群所在的一个城市，尤其是大型城市，尤其是非常好的这个，能够做到很好的把这个参数化模式的这个建筑模式、规划模式更好的运用进去，这个有。 discussion about different things and different factors. It's not only including the boundaries, such as the culture and the people's actual people's influence, something else. So how do you think about the climate system can be applied into different cities related to different parts and different cities, as this student mentioned, is the multi-perspective answer related to
thank you. My answer, well, this new paradigm of working is very much geared up to look at and expect cultural differences with respect to differences of human interaction, of social structure, of pattern communication. And you can see in the lecture that we're starting to simulate. So the brief is not just five programs with square meters, but it's a description of the life process. And then we're trying to simulate. We play out the actors, how they interact, what can be achieved. So it is inherently adaptive to a much larger variety of life patterns than modernism. So within that paradigm, therefore, there is a lot of cultural adaptation built into the very principles of the parameticism, the way I look at it. But the phrase culture is maybe too crude to point to this. This is about, interaction cultures, which become an input, a data input into the design. Jump from here to parallelism is even larger. So yes, it's not only technology based, but it is radically different. Yet, it is still space, it is still intervisibility, there are still categories of spatial understanding and spatial order which continue. And the purpose of learning history And not only traditional architecture, the various stages of development of historical architectures is to start to understand and see how the different societal eras imply different spatial conditions and also different scale of urban order, to then to see the historical lineage, not directly to learn from the old, but to understand the relationship between the historical development of socioeconomic relations and urban formations. But and yet there's still also some aspects which are still similar enough to learn also from ancient architecture.
Okay, thank you, Patrick.
I recommend the study of history for everybody.
我想因为今天下面还会有一个咱们这里边有一个小 party， 那么大家可以在这里要再有问题可以更加随意的提问。因为今天Patrick 给我们带来的这个演讲，我相信应该说在参数化设计领域里面是一个最高端的演讲之一，因为作为扎哈哈蒂德事务所十几年来一直引领着这样一个潮流，包括 Patrick 先生今天自己也谈到了，他说在现代主义Deconstruction Modernism 之后，他又提出来了叫参数化主义。那么参数化主义确实像他今天说的，我们不仅把目光聚焦在很多他非常炫目的参数化的设计的图片上，更多的也给我们提出了很多的问题，包括各位参与提到，比如说如何和地域文化结合，我们那位韩国的听众提到的东大门啊，我不知道大家有没有刚才听明白，他提出东大门的问题如何和当地的韩国的传统文化结合，还有我们自己的观众提到的怎么样能够让领导接受这样一个很昂贵的设计啊，然后还有怎么样去多元的探讨人与人之间相互的理解。从我个人感觉，我觉得他的参数化的主义更多的是给了我们一种思考的方法和思维的方式，我更愿意把它理解为一种methodology， 就是方法学层面的考虑。其实在他的很多的非常精彩的幻灯片里边，我更多的看到的是他对城市对社会所展现出来的一种关注，所以我希望大家和我一样，也不仅仅把它理解为是一种技法，或者说是今天一种建筑师没有办法通过手简单绘制出来的一种技法。那我想这样的话，可能我们未来可以探讨的话题会更多。所以也非常感谢 Patrick 舒马赫先生给我们带来精彩的演讲。当然我们也有希望邀请他作为我们清华建筑学院的客座的教授，作为我们课外的一些指导评审。那么我们也感谢今天参与的嘉宾，不过有点遗憾，我们嘉宾没有阐述你们自己的观点，我想以后我们会有更多的机会。那么也感谢各位包括远道而来的朋友们参与我们这样的一个论坛那么论坛到此结束，我们下面的交流还可以继续，可以大家到我们二楼的小花园里。好，谢谢各位，谢谢。